When he was there last night, it was 3:30.
Hey, everybody. Welcome. Welcomes. We're going to do three songs tonight. Praise and worship. If you know the lyrics, then you don't need the strings. If you don't know the lyrics, they're on the strings. And even still, if that's too fast for you, just tell the Lord how you feel about him. I'm sure that'll work. That always gets through to heaven, doesn't it? And why don't you guys open us up in prayer?
All right. Shinda de la da con papa, de la da que te shishita de tu lado con tu, de la da con papa. Father, we bless this night. We bless it and we decree and declare right now that heaven is here in full force tonight. We decree and declare that your word is here in full force tonight. That our hearts are open, Lord, and that Pastor Eric has a message you have put specifically on his heart to share, God, and this soil is going to receive it. And I pray, God, even the walls absorb it. I pray the carpet absorb it. I pray the streets absorb it. So everybody who walks on this place is going to take that word out of here and start saving lost people in the city. Father, start breaking these walls down. Start doing something in our city never been done in Jesus' name.
Stand and worship the Lord. Push chairs out of the way if you got to. Find your spot. Just get loose with it.
Thank you. Thank you.
Assignment to your family, to your forward, in the name of Jesus, release that nourishment. our seat for Ephesians 3:20 tonight. Let's stand. This is it. This is fourth quarter. This is early time. This is your seat for what he's going to do by the end of this night. This is exceeding abundantly above and beyond any single thing you can ask for in your dream, according to the power of God in you. He hung on the cross for us. We give praise and honor for his time.
Oh, are holy, Lord.
Yes.
Praise you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Praise you, Jesus.
I want to ask you to come share your testimony again that you shared with us, was it last week or the week before? But before we do, I want to wish each and every one of you a happy Mother's Day. All of you who are mothers, happy Mother's Day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And ladies, you're in the right place tonight. Once you hear this message, I promise you, you won't go home the same. Men, it's our night to lift up the ladies. So we're going to pray and intercede. We're going to take in the word. But tonight's all about them. It is. That's the way the Holy Spirit's orchestrated it. So with no further ado, would you just bless us with your testimony?
Yes.
Tell them who you are, what you have for breakfast.
My name is Felicia. My name is Felicia. I'm saying of the Most High God. First, I'd like to give honor, glory to God, all of it. Jesus, my Lord and Savior, Pastor Eric, all my brothers and sisters in Christ. It started 2 years ago. Diabetic colitis. Never heard of it. Didn't even know what it was. But it kept me in and out of the hospital. It was excruciating pains. My stomach, ladies, it was like contractions. Come and go, it would never go away. Kept me in a fetal position in the bed. And I wanted to run for Jesus. I wanted to just be consistent in my walk for the Lord, but it kept hindering me. I was crying out, God, heal me. I know you can. By your stripes, I'm healed. I believe that. I know it, God. I believe that. But some kind of way, it just kept coming back, and doubt crept in there. Doubt crept in there. But I was still praying and believing God for a miracle. I didn't know when it was going to come. So it left me for about 6 months. It's like, I'm healed, thank you, Lord. And it came back. What's going on? The doctors really could, they did every test under the sun, couldn't find nothing. I said, maybe it's an attack. Okay. So I started praying. But I didn't know how to hold on to my healing. Well, the night before my last visit to the hospital, I had a dream. And this big tall man came to my home, and my son said, Mom, the pastor is here. And I got up, I put on my robe, and I came to the front, and it was Pastor Eric. In my dream, I had never met this man before a day in my life. And we sat down on the couch, and I woke up. Well, I went to the hospital the day that I was admitted. Tammy and Pastor Eric and a few little Holy Ghost women came to my ER room. This man I dreamed about, I had never met. I was like, okay, God, this is you. And so he prayed over me. I didn't feel no more pain, but they still wanted to get me to the hospital because of my history. Just to make sure nothing occurred. I was like, okay, what am I going to do? And so I didn't quite know how or what to do to hold on to my healing. So one of the members from Pastor Eric's church, he asked me would I mind if she shared her testimony with me, which did, it blessed me. It encouraged me, and she called me, and she told me how she held on to hers. And sometimes we put faith in man, we need to put faith in God.
Amen.
And that's where we go, that's when we let go. Keep our eyes fixed on the Lord. And that's what I've been doing. More faith.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm healed.
Amen. That's good stuff. Turn in your Bibles, if you would, to Romans chapter 16 and verse 4. I wrote a mini book maybe a year or two ago entitled Hungry Women. And we're going to pull from that tonight. The Holy Spirit told me to start at Romans 16 and 4, so we're going to start there. Before we do, I want to read you something out of a book that I got a couple of years ago at the church I come from in Tennessee. And it's a book by Dutch Sheets and Chuck Pierce, Releasing the Prophetic Destiny of a Nation. And they had a prophetic word for each of the 50 states. Uh-huh. They traveled state to state and let the Holy Spirit gather believers, and they ministered to the Lord, and he had a word. And I'm led to read to you a little bit briefly for South Dakota.
Amen.
Am I saying that right, South Dakota?
South Dakota.
South Dakota. Okay, my bad. I'm from Tennessee. I can just chop it up any old kind of way. South Dakota. Yeah. I went to Pierre, South Dakota. They said, no, it's Pierre. It looked like Pierre to me. But that's the same people that call Louisville Louisville. All right. Chuck Pierce has noticed that there is a strength resident here to take on a national stronghold. This is a quote. If we don't get breakthrough in South Dakota, we don't get the nation. There is a strong man here and there is a stronghold here, but it's supposed to be a key place for the nation. And if we don't get this dealt with, we don't get revival in America. Wow. South Dakota is the least populous state in the nation. But he says if we don't get revival here, we don't get it in America. This is the state slogan is land of infinite variety. God is using all flavors of Christians to join the chorus of the coming kingdom in South Dakota. It's that chord you were probably talking about earlier tonight. He quotes, it says that Dakota means friendship, North and South friendship. God is giving us a new name and identity. The scriptures he quotes are Psalm 88 and 12, Job 11 and 21. Land of forgetfulness and a land of oblivion, gloom, deep shadow, deep night and disorder. But then comes Isaiah 62:4. You will no longer be called desolate, forsaken, or forgotten. You will be called Beulah. Beulah means married to the land, or the land is married. You will be called sought after. So you're a state that God is going to cause people to seek after. I know he's doing it to me. Because I came from a million miles away. This is a quote. I say that there will be three cities in this state that will experience a great move of my spirit. And from the move of my spirit, it will be seen and heard throughout this entire land.
Amen.
You think South, do you think Sioux Falls is one of those cities?
Yeah.
I would say to you, not any would have thought I would have watched after South Dakota. But I say my eye is upon you. And from this place, the nation will begin to be legislated. The eye in the body of Christ is the prophet's office, if you're not familiar with that. So God's got his prophetic eye on you. And let's see what else is in here before we move on. I just thought this would bless you. I'd read the whole thing. That's pretty much it. It's time in this region. It's time to rock the boat a little bit. You're not going to see this broken unless you're willing to get out of the box and let the Lord begin to do some things that are of a supernatural nature.
Amen. Yes.
Pray that the spirit of religion here will be exposed, disarmed, and bound.
Yeah.
Pray for a number of key leaders in churches and key places to break out.
Yeah.
And join God in reaching this nation. If you won't do what I just said, at least have some church-wide regular prayer and worship meetings where all you do is turn into the prophetic anointing and begin to decree the word of the Lord over your city, your people, your region. If you will begin, then by all means, take it outside the doors of your church. And go to these places that we were talking about and do this. If you will do that, you will begin to see things change immediately. Amen. It is time.
Amen.
If you do not heed this word, this stronghold will increase and you will miss the time of your visitation. Mm-hmm. Now I'm telling you by the Spirit of God that this is both a promise and a warning. And so then they talk about Lifelight and how the largest Christian gathering occurs here. And so, if you want to look at this book when we're done, I'll have it here. Please don't take it. I'm a sower, but I also, am wise about it too. So, and I'll do that. If I'm going to Iowa tomorrow, I'm sure they want to hear about Iowa. And we might stop off in Minnesota again. So, turn with me to Romans 16 and 4 if you hadn't already got there. Was that a good word?
Yes.
Let's thank the Lord for that. Let's just... Today on the reservation, we talked about Christianity being called the Great Confession. And then we're not talking about the Catholic religion. That's a whole other kind of confession. We're talking about confessing Jesus as Lord and maintaining that confession every day, daily. And I think that tonight it would be good for the Lord to hear from our words, from our lips, that we commit to do this. So let's say, Lord,
Lord,
help us.
Help us.
Teach us.
Teach us.
To rock the boat a little.
To rock the boat a little.
To get out of our box.
To get out of our box.
To get into church-wide prayer meetings.
To get into church-wide prayer meetings.
City-wide revivals.
City-wide revivals.
Door-to-door outreach.
Door-to-door outreach.
Let us remember the covenant that we have with you.
Let us remember the covenant we have with you.
To join forces together.
To join forces together.
As a mighty voice for you.
As a mighty voice for you.
In this land.
In this,
in this nation.
In this nation.
Let your eye be upon us.
Let your eye be upon us.
And according to Psalm 32 and 8, guide us with your eye.
And according to Psalm 32 and 8, guide us with your front.
And according to Isaiah 62 and 8, direct our work in truth.
And according to Isaiah 62 and 8, direct our work in truth.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen. It's done, isn't it?
Amen.
It's done, because we said it was. Romans 16 and 4 says this, who risked their own necks for my life, to whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. Who are these people Paul is bragging up and down? Well, if we back up to the preceding verse in verse 3, we're going to be introduced to a couple of believers who are co-pastoring a church in their house. Their names are Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus. Now, I have an English degree, but I could have figured this out without that degree. Priscilla is a woman's name, isn't it? And Aquila is a pretty cool guy's name. I'm trying to think, Mama, why didn't you find that one in the Bible? You know, I like Eric, but man, Aquila, that's pretty cool. That's a killer name, isn't it? Yeah. What's your name, Pastor Aquila? I kill them all. I'll have to think on that one a minute. Jesus is all about giving new names, isn't he?
That's right.
Now, hold your finger there. You got 10. We're going to work them all tonight. And go to Galatians 3:28. I'm recording us. I didn't ask you to sign on any waivers, but it's for free, so... You know, but people will want to look in and listen to our service tonight, either live or archived. And so we're trying to capture at least the words as we do this. Galatians 3:28 says this right here. There is, say this with me out loud, there is
neither
Jew
nor Greek.
There is neither.
There is neither
slave nor free.
Slave nor free.
There is neither male.
There is neither male
nor female.
Nor female.
For you are all one.
For you are all one.
In Christ Jesus.
And if you are Christ,
then you are Abraham's seed.
And heirs.
That's not errors, but heirs. God don't make no junk, does he?
Right.
Say that God don't make no junk.
God don't make no junk.
So I'm an heir according to the promise.
I'm heir according to the promise.
What does that mean? There's no male and female. I met a fella girl, I don't know what he was now. I was a little thrown by it. At the hotel where we were holding service today, I had reserved it, and the sign on the thing said Willow, and then when they told me their name, they said it was Lauren, and then I found out today that it's actually Warren.
Oh.
Yeah, so I think that's a little extreme. There's neither male nor female. I don't think that's what the Lord had in mind. But I ran into that today, you know. That was interesting. So we prayed for this person, and we believe it's done in the name of Jesus. What this is saying is that God is a spirit. And so are you. And I don't know if you've thought about this or not, but men, look over at, if you brought a girl tonight, if you brought a woman, a young lady, look over at her real good. Stare at her face. Do you know that God, if he had wanted to, could have put her in a man's body. He can do just anything he wants if you really think about it. He could. But he put her in that home, that house that she's in right now. That's what makes her legal in this earth. She's got a body. That's why the devil's always trying to possess people, because he's an outlaw on this earth. It takes a body to make you legal, not a green card. Okay. Yeah. Takes a body. Does God make mistakes?
No.
Did you know that God is Jewish? Yeah, your Messiah is Jewish. Do you know that typically the Jewish folks are very prudent people, very diligent people? They waste nothing. In fact, that's in their covenant on Isaiah. Blessed. Wasting nor destruction shall no longer be heard in your land. So tonight we're going to stop wasting our appreciation for the houses that Jesus put these ladies in. Religion has wasted hundreds and thousands of years on the battle of the sexes and all that stuff because they were mere natural, carnal-minded religious people at best. Because Paul is drawing attention to this truth. There is a spirit on the inside of them. And if he is or she is equal to the task and equal to us in standing with God. Now, I'm not bypassing the husband's the head of the home. I'm not bypassing that. But I'm talking about in a spiritually effective sense tonight. I'm talking about in reaching this world for Jesus Christ. There is. Say this with me. There is.
There is.
No male.
No male.
Nor female.
Nor female.
We are all one.
We are all one.
We're all spirit beings.
We are spirit beings.
And don't you know that even the shade of her skin was designed by Jehovah Jireh, the Lord our provider. He provided his body with the diversity that he had intended all along. Now, some of you maybe haven't had the privilege. I've had to go to Africa. In Africa, this room would be in total reverse. In fact, there'd probably be even fewer white people in this room in Africa. I saw the same white people in Africa. I saw them all in the mall. I counted 20 different ones. I think it's just the same guy walking around the halls. Yeah. And did you know that God has a purpose for the color of your skin?
Yes.
He has a color for the shade of your skin, whether it be white, brown, yellow, red, or black, or any combination. I'm a walking peace treaty. I'm proof that white folks and red folks can get along long enough to create a baby on both sides of my family. I learned a new term on the reservation this week. Slow grandma.
What?
Well, I wondered. I Googled it. Okay. Couldn't find it in a Native American slang. But I told the Sioux Indians, I said, my ancestors, not ancestors, so ancient, my relatives, okay, I've seen the tombstones, my relatives, on both sides of my family, Scotch, Irish, European men came to the Appalachian Mountains and they snatched up Cherokee women on both sides of the family. And so the Sioux lady said, oh, slow grandma. She just didn't get away. So there's a term for that. I like a new word. But did you know that God had a design for the color of my skin?
Amen.
Do you know that because of that interesting mix there, it's very rare that I walk into a room with a diverse faces and anyone feel uncomfortable? Really. Because really the predominant thing is what is he? Yeah. I get stopped pretty frequently and ask that question. Oftentimes I'll have people walk up and just start speaking Spanish. I'm like, slow down. I know where you're coming from, brother. I appreciate it, but no. But I'm learning Spanish because I've been pastoring in Florida for so long, and I've had 4 years of it in school. But that's not it. I've had people when I was in college working out at a gym run over after the Acts class and start speaking Italian. You Italiano? You Italiano? No. Sister, that ain't it. But Sicily's all right with me because they got good pizza, right? Yeah, yeah. Recently, I was in Pipestone at the Lord's house, and someone asked me, are you all American? I said, well, I like Mexican food, too. They said, no, I mean, are you all American? Oh, okay. I got you. I've had a principal at an inner city high school call me on the intercom. I thought I was in trouble. We were doing Christian clubs in her school, and I was told, man, she's tough. Don't get on her bad side. So she's called me into her office, and I'm in there with fear and trembling. And I sit down, and she says, I want to know something. I was like, oh, God. There goes the club right there. We've done something to offend somebody. And she says, were your ears burning this weekend? I was like, why? She goes, because we were talking about you. I said, oh, my goodness. She says, I want to know, what is your ethnicity? She was trying to hook me up with her daughter. So, yeah, it's interesting. But you know that really what God sees is my spirit, man?
Amen.
But he designed me in such a way to be an effective witness for him. With my height, my build, my skin color, the sound of my voice, even my birthmark. I think the Lord's starting to go, no, let's make you work for it. Either that or I once was and I've been fading fast. But anyway, it's good to laugh, isn't it? But your wife, these ladies, these gals, God sees them in ways you might not even see it yourself as confident as you are in your womanhood. And we're going to just dig deep into that tonight. That'd be all right? Can we do that?
Yeah.
All right. I want you to leave high as a kite tonight. Say it one more time. There is no male.
There is no male.
There is no female.
There is no female.
In Christ Jesus.
In Christ Jesus.
Let's go back over to Romans 16. And let's start at verse 1. Do you guys like eating hamburgers? Because I hope you do, because we're going to kill some sacred cows tonight. We're going to chop them up and fry them up. We might have some beefalo burgers, some buffalo and beef burgers. Romans 16 and 1. I commend to you Phoebe, our sister. Phoebe's name in the Greek means firelight. Luminous. That's what her name means. Who is a servant of the church in Centuria. Now, you've got to bear with the King James translators. They did the best they could with the revelation that they have. Yes. But this word servant is a bit weak. Say that with me. Weak.
Weak.
Because it's actually the word diakonos, which is the same word for deacon or deaconess. Now, a deacon has a number of responsibilities in the Bible, some of which are handling money. Yeah. It's very likely Phoebe delivered this letter to this church at Rome, handed to her from Paul himself. They would do house visits. They would pray for people. They would share the word. Tremendous amounts of responsibility. She would be someone you would find in 1 Corinthians 12 and 28, where it says, the ministry of helps. Turn there with me real quickly. 1 Corinthians 12 and 28. And God, say it with me, God
has
appointed
these in the church.
So what we're about to talk about is the office of governments in the local church. What did he say about the church? He says, the gates of hell shall not prevail against my church. So anything he appointed in his church is triumphantly victorious over the gates of hell at all times. So he says, first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, after that miracles and gifts of healings, helps. Helps. This is Phoebe Firelight. Okay? In this mini book, we have an entire chapter dedicated to Phoebe. She's chapter 2. If I'm friends with you on Facebook, and that's the noise you keep hearing, bloop, people responding to stuff, I put a free copy of this on Facebook. If I'm not friends with you on Facebook, and I have it on my Hotmail account. So if you want to leave your address or email on one of these love offering envelopes tonight, I will send you a copy via email for free. okay? And you can copy and paste it and pass it on. I have soft copies that I'm all sold out of, or I brought them with me, but I can give it to you online right now till we reorder soft copies. It's 45 pages. It's just a little mini book. So anyway, turn with me back to Romans 16 and look at verse 2. And what we're talking about tonight is just highlighting what's in this book. Okay, since I'm giving it for free, you know I'm not doing it with twisted motives. Okay, we're just giving it away. Today's Mother's Day, and this is what the Holy Spirit said to minister. That you may receive her in the Lord in a manner worthy of the saints, and assist her in whatever business she has need of you. For indeed she has been a helper of many, and of myself also. Paul wrote this letter to the leaders of the church at Rome, who were mostly men, as it is in a lot of places. And he said to these men, whatever she needs, get it done. Say that with me. Get her done.
Get her done.
That's Phoebe, and that's 2,000 years ago. And God appointed it. God anointed it. And God ordained it. But I thought women weren't supposed to usurp authority over a man. I thought they weren't permitted to speak in church. Oh, I'm so glad you brought that up. Because we're going to kill those cows in a minute. And I'll just give you a hint right now. The word woman in those verses is the word in the Greek for wife. So not everybody would have had a wife. And that's one of the reasons why he said to tell them to be quiet. But we're going to talk about that in a minute. But it had to do with seating arrangement and education, both of which are null and void right now. So, moving right along. Greet Priscilla and Aquila. I got a little nudge. Before we move on to Priscilla and Aquila, go right here to chapter 2. Let's scroll down a little bit. The word deacon, which is used for her help and service to the Lord. Someone just did a friend's request, but they're in this room. he says, it is diakonos, and it means to run on errands, an attendant, a waiter, a Christian teacher and pastor, technically a deacon or deaconess. It's from the word dia and conus, which means thoroughly raise up dust by moving in a hurry, and so to minister in sacred service. Phoebe was a little Speedy Gonzales for Jesus. Was she not? Uh-huh. We could make a cartoon about Phoebe. Say, I have no problem.
I have no problem.
Being like a Phoebe.
Being like a Phoebe.
From my Lord and Savior.
From my Lord and Savior.
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
I'll kick up dust.
I'll kick up dust.
Moving in a hurry.
Moving in a hurry.
For him.
For him.
To perform any sacred service he needs.
To perform any sacred service he needs.
All right. That's good stuff, isn't it?
Amen.
You need to. This is a good book. The Bible's a good book. We should read it sometime. It's good.
Amen.
There's a lot of good stuff in there. And you can get all that out of a Strong's Concordance. You don't have to have a post-hole digger, a PhD. You can get it right out of a Strong's. Yeah, you sure can. Did you know that a spirit of religion and a spirit of division are what has put women down for so long? That's the devil. That's not God. The devil magnifies difference in hate. God magnifies difference in love. That's quoted Brother Comfort from 1996 in Atlanta at the Albany. I'll never forget it. Moving right along, greet Priscilla and Aquila. Whose name is first?
Priscilla.
2,000 years ago, friends. There wasn't no women's suffrage movement. No. America, we think we're so involved. And how long have y'all been able to vote? Not long, has it been? Not long at all. But you look out, who's the true liberator? The Holy Spirit. The Word of God. And if we just do things His way, we'd get a whole lot more done, wouldn't we? I'll be honest with you. In my experience, 80% of the work in the church is done by women anyway. You might as well give them props. Don't be afraid to hang a name and a title on them if God so leads you. They're doing the work already anyway.
Yeah.
Might as well just realize it. Now, he says, They are my fellow workers who risk their own necks for my life, to whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. Are you serious? Do you think that if she kept silent in every church she went to, that he'd be giving her props right now? I mean, honestly, think about it. Think about it. All the churches, every one of the churches, give her thanks. That's a lot of churches, friends. There's a lot of room for maneuverability in interpreting this, in terms of let your women keep silent. Do you know why he told them to keep silent? Because back in Paul's day, the women were less educated, and they would sit on one side of the room, and the men would sit on the other side. And while the speaker was speaking, they'd be hollering over at their husbands, "Hey, what does he say? What's that mean?" And it was interrupting the speaker. And so in order to keep order in the service, he said, "Tell them to wait till you get home and ask the questions." Because it's disrupting. You know, anything with two heads is a freak. And you got two people speaking at the same time, it's just hard to get anything done, isn't it?
That's right.
That's what was going on. I've seen this in India. I've seen this in Africa. With my own eyes. That's what he was talking about. But you know, I got this nudge in my spirit that as liberating as we're trying to be tonight, there are some women, maybe some in here, maybe some you know, who enjoy hiding behind those verses so that they're not called on to do anything. Yeah. Maybe they left already. Maybe they didn't come tonight. Maybe the devil preoccupied them. But you shouldn't be hiding behind that any longer. Because that's the devil. And he's robbing you of your destiny, if that's you. Not only you, but the kids coming after you. What about your daughter? Do you want her suffocated in her walk with God? I think not. And you know, a lot of times they won't do what you won't do. They're going to do what you do. They need a leader. And maybe you didn't have one. Well, somebody's got to start somewhere. Amen. Say, the buck stops here.
The buck stops here.
It's a whole new day up in here. Verse 5, likewise, greet the church that is in their house. Are you serious? He just named Priscilla before he named Aquila, and in the same breath, he said, "Oh, in the church in their house." Now, honestly, think about this. If he really intended for all women to be silent in the church, which you know it would never happen, the Red Sea parted in before that happened. That don't even work out in the world, much less in the church. You know what I'm talking about? How many words per day do y'all have that we don't have? Was it 2-to-1, 3-to-1? Yeah. Y'all using two sides of your brain. We're trying to figure out how to use the one. I don't even know if it's the left or the right. It's in there somewhere. Yeah. Oh, you want to stir up religious devils? Talk about women preachers. But you know what? I just don't really care. I really don't. I'm so delivered from it. I can serve you because I don't care. I mean, I do, but I really don't. So anyway, don't you think that Paul knew the risk he was taking when he mentioned her first and then in the same breath mentioned the church in their house? I mean, honestly, if he really wanted to just keep women silent, shouldn't he have said something like this? Greet Aquila and the church in his house. Don't you think? If he really wanted to make it plain and clear, he'd have left her name out of it altogether. Mm-hmm. Why run the risk of somebody misinterpreting that? But you know, that's not the only time he mentioned her name first. Go to Acts chapter 18 and verse 18. So there was something to this. Acts chapter 18 and verse 18. I film messages in Florida on Tuesday nights at a leadership school called Soul University. The contact information is on this card here, and The website's right here on the bottom, if you need to make a copy, I've got one of these left. And we generally average 40 or 50 views per show once they've been up there for any length of time. There's the live show, there's the people in the audience, and then there's the people that watch on the archives. This particular message, filmed September the 20th of 2011, I remember because it's just astronomical how many views it's gotten, is somewhere around 200 plus. Four times the number of views any other show, not even a close second place, was this Hungry Women. If that's not a hot button in the spirit, I don't know what is. I just don't know. Now, Acts 18 and 18, so Paul still remained a good while. Then he took leave of the brethren and sailed for Syria, and Priscilla and Aquila were with him. There he goes mentioning her name first again. Isn't that something? Turn with me in your Bibles. Let's go back up to chapter 1. And look at Psalm 68 and 11. I told you, bear with the King James translators of the Bible. They did the best they could with the revelation they had. But when this was written, there wasn't a whole lot of women preachers. Okay, when they were translating the Bible. Just wasn't a whole... Joan of Arc was probably the closest thing they could find. Okay? And then Deborah in the Bible herself, and the other ones we'll read about. But thank God for progress, I guess that's what you call it. Actually, I think it was regress, and now we're just trying to catch back up to where they were originally. Psalm 68 and 11. Now, this is the King James. The Lord gave the word. Great was the company of those who proclaimed it. Now, if you're just reading that through, what are you going to think? You think, man, I mean, you're just reading that. That's probably what you're going to think. But if you look at all these other translations, look at the Amplified. The Lord gives the word of power. The women who bear and publish the news are a great host. That's pretty specific, isn't it? Look at it in the NIV. The Lord announces the word, and the women who proclaim it are a mighty throng. Isn't that something? Psalm 68:11, Young's literal translation, the Lord doth give the saying, the female proclaimers are a numerous host. The New American Standard Bible says, the Lord gives the command, and the women who proclaim the good tidings are a great host. Great host, great company. Publishing and proclaiming the word of God, the word of power. Ladies, do you journal? Do you email? Do you blog? Do you video messages? Do you do daily devotions online? You can do all that stuff for free. I'm doing it. I just don't have a wig on and a dress. Probably won't either. Although one time I dressed up in a tutu to get some kids to come to church. Whatever it takes, dude, to get them in there. Anyway, I was in Bible school in 1997, the first Bible school I went to. And I was renting this house out with some fellas. And it was a two-story house, and I chose the big bedroom in the back. And Dillard's department store was giving me all kinds of clothes to give out to people that were returns. Like they had too many, or a button was missing, or was out of style. Over a period of about 11 years, I gave out about $500,000 worth of free Dillard's clothes and stuff. Just intercepting it before it hit the trash can. Giving it to missionaries, Bible school students, pastors, their wives, people in the hood, people in the suburbs. You know, the Lord really got me about always giving everything to the poor. He says, you know, just use the 3-foot rule. Anybody within 3 feet of you is a candidate to get something. Everybody's got challenges, and I love rich people just like I love poor people. So you quit being prejudiced.
That's
what he said. Yeah. One time a chiropractor took me home from a service, and the Holy Spirit said, give him that pair of 12 dress shoes in your bag there from Dillard's that you got today. I said, Lord, are you sure? This guy's, he's a doctor. He just told me he started his own vitamin company. He's white. And he's living in the suburbs in a big old house. He says, give him the shoes, dude. They're not yours anyway.
Come on now.
Don't let those sticky fingers start funding the gospel. It'll never get done. That administration cap is what, 55%? No, that's not how the Lord does it. So, anyway, I gave him shoes. He stopped the car in the middle of the street and started crying. I kid you not. I thought, what in the world, is he going crazy? He pulled his shoe off. It had a hole the size of my phone in it. He says, I have no retirement because I'm a chiropractor. My benefits are just pitiful. Psalm 68:19 promises you daily benefits. Psalm 103, 2 through 6 names some of those benefits. Actually, in Hebrew, Psalm 68:19 means every day is your birthday. Yesterday was my mom's birthday. Today's Mother's Day. I asked her, what are you going to do for an encore tomorrow? He says, and so I started this vitamin company using this thing called CoQ10. And it's taken all the savings, all the reserves I have. I didn't even have enough money to buy a pair of shoes. And you know, you have to put on an image as a doctor. And he says, so when it rains, man, my socks just splosh. He says, you don't even know how much this means to me. You know, a few years later, he wrote me a check for a mission trip. A nice, healthy check. Really, a healthy one. Because his business had prospered. He had actually sold the business by then. And that was a portion of what he made off of it. You can't be prejudiced towards wealthy people. You can't be prejudiced towards anybody. Especially not yourself. Did you know you need a blessing sometimes? And you don't need to get everything to everybody else? And sometimes you take yourself out. Yeah. Because what you won't do for you, you definitely won't do for others. And you really can't love your neighbor and your God till you love yourself. Isn't that what it says? So, there's a healthy term I want you to remember tonight. Enlightened self-interest. Enlightened self-interest. Take care of yourself. If you don't, who will? If you're waiting on God, He's waiting on you. While we're here, turn to 1 Corinthians 14, 34 and 35. First Corinthians chapter 14, verses 34 and 35. Let your women keep silent in the churches, for they are not permitted to speak, but they are to be submissive, as the law also says. And if they want to learn something, let them ask their own husbands at home, for it is shameful for women to speak in church. If that were the case, she definitely would have been able to testify in here today. But did that bless you on her healing testimony?
Yeah.
Was the Holy Spirit just all over that?
Yeah.
Sounds like he didn't take his medication when he wrote that, does it? Somebody's confused. I got a question for you. Are you married?
No.
Are you married? Are you married?
Not yet.
Who in here is not married? Women. One, two, three, four, five. Single man, don't be looking around. One, two, three, four, five, six. Six single ladies in here. How in the world are you supposed to obey this verse if it says, if you want to learn something, let them ask their own husbands at home? How are you going to do that? You ever thought about that? If you ain't got no husband, how are you going to ask him at home? You'd be doubly in the dark, wouldn't you? So just reading that right there ought to tell you the word woman is not correctly translated, or not least as good as it could have been. If you go to the Greek, that word woman is the word for wife. And it's just exactly like I told you. The men sat on one side, the women sat on the other. The men had the education, the women didn't. And so, and it was really out of hunger and passion for the things of God. They were even opening their mouth anyway. They would holler over at their husbands, what is he talking about? What does that mean, what he just said, as he's preaching to us? And it was disrupting the whole thing. So Paul said, tell them to wait till you get home to ask you what everything meant. But now, women, is there anybody in here with a college education or getting a college education? Raise your hand. Most everybody. So we know that it wouldn't hold water today. Actually, a lot of times, it's the other way around now. Women have gotten education, and men, well, we're getting there. You know? And I don't want to preach this at the expense of men. This is not to bash men. This is not, because I just could easily go over and talk about men too, in a good, positive, uplifting way. But tonight, this is where he said to go. Plus, it's Mother's Day. How can you go wrong with that? So a lot of, you know, women aren't needing to ask men questions like that nowadays, because you got education, you got all the ghost education, you know what's up. You know, your husband's not your Lord. God is.
That's right.
Yeah. So the word is wife, not women. There went one cow. Now, it's number 1135 in the Greek, in case you think I'm lying. Go to Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2, verse 28. We all love this scripture, don't we? Joel chapter 2, verse 28. And I'm not preaching this for brownie points either. I'm really not. I've preached 9,000 different things since I've been up here. And I didn't know I was preaching this till I woke up from a deep sleep on the way here from the reservation. And right before I woke up, he said, Romans 16:4, now you can wake up. And now you know where to start tonight. That's clear as a bell. Joel 2:28. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Hold your finger there and go to 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 5. I wish all you spoke with tongues, but even more that you prophesied. For he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks with tongues, unless indeed he interprets, that the church may receive edification. There are four gifts found in 1 Corinthians 12 that are to be predominant in the home local church. It's not saying that the other five wouldn't manifest. But a lot of times those have to do with specific equippings and callings in a public fashion. In your private life, God wants to manifest all nine gifts as the need arises. Somebody asked Brother Oral Roberts, what's the greatest gift? He says, the one that you need at the moment. Pretty good sense, right there. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. That dog will hunt. I just love these colloquial expressions. I saw a dog in the back of a truck today. I said, literally, that dog will hunt. That's a hound dog. Probably plays a record and sings a song, too. Probably knows Elvis. So he said in Joel that in the last days, and Peter quotes this at the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, he stands up in the midst of all of those people and said, men and brethren, these are not drunk as you suppose. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. But this is that. Say, this is that.
This is that.
Which the prophet Joel spoke.
Which the prophet Joel spoke.
And he quotes what we're reading tonight. The four gifts that are predominantly manifesting in the home local church are tongues, you might want to write this down, speaking in tongues, the interpretation of tongues, gifts of healing, and prophecy. Those four, above all the others, ought to be more dominant in the local church. Why? Because these are the giftings that God set in the church to beautify, multiply, increase the local church. And they are for anybody. The others, in a public setting, generally follow those called to specific offices. Not to get too deep with you tonight, but for instance, the office of the New Testament prophet, I don't care what the business card says, I don't care what the church sign says. I don't care what they were introduced as. But the proof is in the pudding. It's by function and not by title alone.
Amen.
A New Testament prophet is not a standalone office. It's always accompanied with one of the other fivefold ministry gifts, usually the teacher. Not limited to, but often we see that in the Bible. You can go through there and look all that up if you want. So if you are a prophet, well, then you also have another call as well attached to it. So you can't, because some people use it as a pride poker. Or try to lord over you. I'm a prophet. Look, if you got to tell me, maybe you aren't. Let me just let God be God, okay? Let's see. Okay. They are someone who flows in two of the three revelation gifts. The majority of the revelation gifts. Publicly, accurately, and consistently. And those gifts are the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, and discerning of spirits. If you're not flowing consistently, publicly, and accurately, regularly, in those giftings and some others, that ain't you. Maybe God's talking to you about that office, but it ain't time yet. You're going to probably start scrubbing commodes somewhere. Work your way up from the ministry of helps. And be faithful with a few things so that you can be made ruler over many. Be faithful with money so you can be handed true riches. Just tell them, okay? And it's not a novice. So if you've been saved about a day and a half, that ain't you. It's not. God may be showing you the end from the beginning, but if you've known anything about God, one day with Him is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as a day. Okay? And Paul didn't start off as an apostle. He started off as a prophet and a teacher. Yeah. And his was a graduate experience because it was the onset of the church. Well, the church is 2,000 years old now. God's not in a hurry. Okay. He can develop these gifts during a long period of time because he's got a foundation for the church. They didn't when Paul came on the scene. It was just, bam, like that. That's God calling. Now, if you're a teacher, you can teach. If you're a prophet, you can prophesy. So you want to add prophecy to the New Testament prophet. But just because you prophesied, you can ask Philip's four virgin daughters about this in the book of Acts. Just because you prophesied doesn't make you a prophet or a prophetess. It doesn't. Now, they usually have a strong healing ministry as well. And there's some other things, but that's a good start for you right there. The apostle is someone who, as the need arises, flows between all five of the fivefold ministry gifts. They are, first and foremost, a sent one. The word missionary is not in the New Testament, nor the Old. Man made that name up. If you really are a true missionary, you're an apostle. You're a church planter. Okay? Now, just because you planted a church doesn't make you an apostle necessarily. It's plural, churches. And again, not a novice. And it takes time for this to unfold. And you really ought to let others notice it about you. There ought to be a consensus before you go tell everybody about it. Try to convince them. You know, faith comes by hearing. If I tell you a lie long enough, eventually you'll believe it, right? Isn't that how it works? So, they'll flow between an apostle, a prophet, a pastor, a teacher, and an evangelist. And I'll tell you right now, ministry helps as that arises too. Because sometimes there ain't nobody to clean them commodes but you. And if you're too big to do it, then you probably don't need to be running around as an apostolos, as the Greek calls you. Probably not. Anyway, how do we get off on that? Oh, because of the other five gifts. So some of these other more spectacular, if you will, giftings follow calls and offices. It doesn't mean you couldn't have a word of wisdom manifest in your life. Doesn't at all. In fact, if you need one, get one. But it's as the Spirit wills. And you know, while we're on this, let's say, for instance, a New Testament a prophet appears. We should, I'm a stickler for the word. You don't have the gift of the word of wisdom. You don't. You have that gift manifest as the Spirit wills. If you had it, you could conjure it up anytime. But that's not how it works. Now, to an outsider looking in, a lot of times it looks like you have that gift because God wills it all the time in your life because that goes with who you are and what you do. But we shouldn't say, I've got this and I've got that. There's several gifts that are built into the born-again personality, and those are found in Romans 12. Those, yeah, you do possess. You got a dominant one. Everybody does. But these others are as the Spirit wills. And prophecy is one of those gifts in Romans 12. Giving is another one. I don't know a whole lot of people walking around claiming that gift. I got the gift of somebody. Praise God for it, too. 100-fold return, brother.
No, I claim it.
Oh, okay.
You wouldn't say what I said.
Ah, okay. Now, moving right along, women. We're about to show you in a very fast fashion ministry of helps, a deaconess. We showed you that. We just showed you a female pastor, Priscilla. We're going to show you a female apostle and a couple other things. So, go with me back to Romans 16. And this is just one chapter in the Bible. The point I wanted to make when I had you turn to 1 Corinthians and show you the ministry of helps, and then 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 5 about the prophesying in the church. The Bible says the Holy Spirit pours out His Spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions, your old men will dream dreams. All my men servants, my maid servants, I'll pour out my Spirit. Yeah. Well, in the church, friends, and it's in God's mind that women prophesy in the church. That's the context that it's written in. He says of all the gifts in the local church, the one I'd like to see the most is prophecy. Who do you say He's going to inspire to prophesy? Men and women. Don't do this. Don't say, well, if we're in the four walls of the church, she better not prophesy. She's not permitted to speak in the church. Nor do you serve authority over a man. She had better get out in the parking lot, and then she can shaman a hamen and interpret it all day long if she wants to. Because see, that hypocrite that says that's the same one that will tell you the church is not the building. So if you use that same logic, when she's standing on that sidewalk, would you be okay with, because she's not in the building, you just became a hypocrite because the church ain't the building. That's the church out there on the sidewalk too. You can't have all that going on in your head, all that stinking thinking. I know this is hard for people that have been religiously brainwashed and trained this way. I know. Some people, it dies hard. It does. But guys, we might as well just get used to it. And you might as well just start preaching it. Because God's going to be doing it with or without you. And it's going to happen. It's happening now. So in the church, He desires women to prophesy. And if you've looked out in the audience lately, there's a lot of times more 2-to-1, women to men. So if it's limited to men, it'd be an awful quiet church, wouldn't it? We call those the church of the frozen chosen. Pastored by pastor disaster. You graduated from the seminary. No, if you just want to loosen things up a bit, you want the Holy Ghost to move in your church, let Him use the women. Freely. I mean, just regularly. And believe God for it.
Yeah.
Not just in the church, but in the home. And in the streets. And in the marketplaces. And in the schools. Because you know what? Truth be told, if you just want to knock over another sacred cow of false humility, if I'm prophesying to you, is it me or is it the Holy Ghost? So it's not her anyway, you numbskull. It's the Holy Ghost, isn't it? And when she's doing it out of her spirit. And we just read right there, according to Paul, there is no male or female in Christ. In the spirit, there is no male or female. That's why they don't make babies in heaven. It's the spirit realm. It's a whole other existence. It's a whole higher level of stuff. We just get swirling. Men just, you know, don't want nobody usurping their authority in front of them. They do it to other men, too. They ain't just limited to women. Because they're little boys that won't grow up. Yeah. The Bible says in the last days, men's hearts will fail them for fear. Men struggle with fear probably more than anything in the last days. Fear and pride are rooted together. The Bible says you've been given a spirit of power, love, and of a sound, disciplined mind. Not a spirit of fear. Fear is a spirit. Bind it. Be a big enough man to let women flourish in your presence. Be confident enough to allow them to be big as God wants to make them. And quit looking at them as a female to begin with. Unless you're married to them, then look all you want. As long as you don't knock your side of the head and say, hey, pay attention. I know I'm pretty. I know I got it going on. But this is what the preacher's saying. We gotta have a paradigm shift. We gotta shake things up a little bit, don't we? This will shake it, man. This will shake it. That money. I got two testimonies I want to give you about money before I forget them. On the reservation, we were doing a Bible study at a woman's home. Matter of fact, I was the only guy in there until this couple walked in off the street. I don't know if they're married or if they were just dating. But she snagged two more walking down the street into the Bible study. And they came in on just a hot mess. Their lights were off. It was going to cost $717 to get the lights turned back on. That's a lot of money whether you're on the reservation or not for a light bill. And so I called them. Some of you were here when we taught on how to believe God for money. Claim what you need. Tell the devil to take his hands off of it. Commission angels to go and influence people for your good, and then stand in faith, thanking and praising God for the amount you believe for. That is a sober estimation of your faith. Don't get ridiculous claiming 10 million oil wells. What would you do with one? That's less than 10 million. Okay? I said, so, if I hear you correctly, right now today, yesterday, you need $717. I said, I will venture to say that's not all you need, is it? And I just heard this in my spirit. Claim 1,000 for them. Now, I can carry babies for a little while. But eventually, they're going to grow up. You wouldn't want to see a 50-year-old mowing the yard in diapers, would you?
Nope.
That's just ugly, just even thinking about that. Cast that imagination down. Bring that thought into subjection right now. That's making me think of the one at the hotel. Was it Lauren or Warren? Or? So I handed them some money. I said, when you have a need, plant a seed, and then